All right, so we're back, and in the previous video, we set up our checkpoint system. So if I play in the editor here again, I can drive through our checkpoint, our little trigger there. And as we drive through it, it has disappeared from the level, which is exactly what we want. So there it is again. And if we drive through it, now it disappears. So we've set up our individual checkpoint. Over the next couple videos, we're going to be working on the system that monitors all of the checkpoints in our level. So that we can place multiple checkpoints and have them turn on and off sequentially as the player enters the previous checkpoint. So that system is going to be set up inside of our tracker blueprint. So we're going to start working on that next. Before we start working on the tracker, though, there is one thing that we need to do for our checkpoint blueprint itself. So down on the content browser, go ahead and open up the checkpoint blueprint. And with it open, hop up to the components tab. Or components window, go ahead and select the trigger. Then down in the details panel, for testing purposes, we had unchecked hidden in game so that we can see it inside of our level. We're actually going to recheck this now because we're going to call this through script when we want to make our trigger volume visible in game and eventually our particle system too. So recheck hidden in game. And then we also want to scroll down and under the collision section, go ahead and uncheck generate overlap events, because we're also going to call this through script. We only want to be able to overlap our triggers when we turn them on in game. So with that, go ahead and compile and save and then close out this blueprint. So the next thing we will do is work on our tracker here. And as I mentioned, this will keep track of all of the checkpoints that we place in our level. So let's go ahead and get started on that. Go ahead and open up the tracker blueprint. And the very first thing that we're going to do actually is hop up to the components window. We're just going to add one single component here. So go ahead and click the add component button and search for a billboard component. So right here, and it says a billboard is a 2D texture that will be rendered always facing the camera. We're just going to use this as a method of being able to see our tracker in our level. So if I drag this and drop it on top of the root here like so and compile, and save, and then hop back to our level. And I drag our tracker into the level. So just left click and drag it into the level. We have some kind of a visual indication of where this object is now. And this thing will always face us. So we have this little dinosaur icon face thing here. That'll let us know where the tracker is. You can also, if you'd like, hop over to the details panel and kind of scale it up. Say maybe 1.5 by 1.5, 1.5. So it just looks a little bit bigger. But this is going to be a pretty important blueprint because it's going to contain all of the custom settings that we want to apply for our race here. So anything that we want to change for our race is going to be done right here inside of the details panel for this blueprint. So it's going to be pretty important to know where it is inside of our level. You can also search inside of the world outliner in the upper right up here. You could just search for tracker and select it this way as well. We wanted to add a single component just so that we could see it. So back in our tracker blueprint now, we are going to do some setup here, kind of like what we did for the player controller blueprint. We're just going to add all the variables and all the functions that we need in this video. Probably in the next video, we'll start working on the event graph portion of this blueprint. And then the video after that, we'll finish off some of the functions that we're going to be adding, and then finally testing our system. So we got a lot of work to do in here, but we're going to bang it out in the next couple videos. So first things first, let's start creating our variables. So we're going to hop over to the My Blueprint panel, and we're going to click the Add Variable button. So we can add a variable. And this first variable that we're going to create is called Max Laps. And we're going to change this to an integer. So go down to the Details panel and make sure that it is an integer. We're also going to make sure that the variable is publicly editable, and this will allow us to edit it inside of the details panel of the level editor. And we'll show you this here in a moment. So go ahead and enter a tooltip as well. The max lap variable is just the user defined maximum laps for the race, or enter any tooltip that you think will help you. And the last thing that we're going to do is assign it to a category just for organizational purposes. We're going to call this the custom settings category. And that will nest it right under this header here. So if we compile now and we hop back to the level again one more time with our tracker selected, If we look over in the details panel now, we have a section called custom settings where our level designer friends or our artists can come in and specify right here how many laps they want this race or this map to have. So this is just going to be a way of making things more user-friendly for yourself and other designers or artists working on your projects. They can come in and create their maps, and then they can specify all the settings for the map right here in the details panel. Instead of having to track down the My Player Controller blueprint, opening it up and finding the variables that we have in there and setting them there, we're just going to pass these variables from our tracker to our My Player Controller automatically so that we can edit them right here in the details panel. So having said that, let's continue adding the rest of our variables. We have a couple more here to add. So I'm going to select our max laps here, and I'm going to hit Control W to duplicate it so that it is nested under our custom settings. And the next one that we're going to add is going to be called Gold Time. This is going to be the time needed to reach a gold status. So let's change this to a float, actually. So I'm going to go down to the Details panel and make this float, like so. And for this, I'm going to actually delete the tooltip because it's pretty self-explanatory, but feel free to add a tooltip if you'd like. So we have our gold time. I'm going to select gold time and hit Control W again. And we're also going to need silver time. I'm going to hit Control W again, and we need bronze time as well. A couple other settings that we want to allow ourselves or designers or artists to set inside the details panel. So let's go ahead and continue and add those. Control W again. We want to be able to set the default best lap. So what is the default best lap time? Control W, default best race. All right, let's just call it best time. That's better. Default best time. Control W again. We also want to allow ourselves to name the map. So name of map. We're going to change this variable type to a text variable type. Let's do Control W again. We also want to be able to define the save game name. And this variable type needs to be a string, actually. So we're going to change this to a string, like so. And let's also allow the our designer friends and artists to set the level music and checkpoint sound effect that plays. So we'll make that a custom setting as well. So let's add another variable. So Control W again, and we'll name this level music. And this is going to be an ambient sound. So let's search for ambient sound. And we're going to go ahead and choose the ambient sound object reference here. Now for this one, I'm going to add a tooltip. The tooltip for this one is going to state that you need to add a sound to the level first, exclamation point. With this variable, in order for us to set this, we're going to have to add a sound effect to the level, and then we'll be able to select from a drop down any of the sounds that we have in the level that we want to use and actually play for the level music and our checkpoint sound effect. So let's go ahead and do one more, Control W, and call this checkpoint sound effects, like so. Going to compile up here at the top, and it says we're good to go. Going to set some default values for these now so that they are not all zeros. So we're going to set some default values. So for max lap, I'm going to set that to 2. For gold time, I'm going to set that to 60 seconds. Feel free to set these to whatever you'd like. I'm going to change the silver time to 120, so 2 minutes. The bronze time, we'll set that to 180. The default best lap, let's set that to 60. The default best time, we'll set that to 120. The name of the map, let's just call this first map the loop-de-loop map, like so. The save game name, now the save game name, if you're going to be saving per level, per map, it's probably a good habit to get into some form of consistency in your naming convention. So I'm going to go ahead and call mine the LL for the name of my map there. So abbreviated loop-de-loop underscore save game. So anytime I create any additional maps, I'll abbreviate it with the name of the map and then save game. Level music and checkpoint sound effects, we're going to have to set those in the level in a moment. So let's go ahead and compile. Let's save. And let's hop back to the level now. And if we look in the details panel, there are all those glorious settings that we can set now, which we'll drive through script a little bit later and pass those over to our player controller so that they get applied. But again, you see the usefulness now that we can set these values right here instead of going inside of our player controller and manually setting them inside the blueprint. So let's go ahead and add our level music and checkpoint sound effects while we're at it. You see again, if I mouse over it, it says you need to add a sound to the level first. So let's go ahead and do that. I'm gonna go to the audio folder inside the content browser. I'm gonna take our blueprint text pop here, just left click and drag that into the level. I'm gonna take the realistic rendering music here, just gonna drag that into the level like so. Now if we select our tracker, the dinosaur guy here, we go over to level music, click this drop down. We now have those two sound effects that are in our level. For the level music, we're gonna use the rendering music. So go ahead and select that. And the checkpoint sound effects, go ahead and select this. And let's go ahead and select that. So all of our custom settings are applied. We've created them. We're about 10 minutes in. We're gonna create our functions and then we're gonna pause and start doing some scripting in the next video. So let's finish off our tracker. I'm gonna go back to the tracker now. I'm gonna collapse custom settings. There's a couple more variables that we need to add. One of those will be publicly editable, but we're not gonna put it in the custom settings section. We're gonna put it in its own section because it's pretty important. So let's go ahead and add one more variable here. This variable is going to be called checkpoints. And this is going to keep track of all the checkpoints that we place in our level. So we're going to have to change this from an ambient sound. Let's change the variable type to checkpoint. And what we are saying here, we are referencing our checkpoint blueprint here. So we're going to have several checkpoint blueprints stored in this variable here. So let's click checkpoint. And we need to make this an array so that we can have more than one. We're gonna store all of the checkpoints in the level inside of here. So go ahead and make sure that it's an array by clicking this icon here. It will change the icon like so. Let's make sure that it is publicly editable. This is very important. So make sure that it's publicly editable. And for the tooltip, we are going to say you must assign all checkpoints from the level to this array. So you must assign all checkpoints to the from the level to this array in order for our system to work. Next thing we're going to do is add it to a category. We're going to give it its own category because, again, it's pretty important. So let's just say checkpoints is the name of the category. We're going to compile and save and hop back to the level. And if we look in the details panel, we have a new section called checkpoints with our checkpoints array. And again, it's telling us you must assign all checkpoints from the level to the array because currently it is set to 0. So what we're gonna do for our system here is add all the checkpoints that we want in our array. So if I fly out, we can add a bunch of checkpoints all around our map. Once we have all the checkpoints that we want, we will click this plus sign here to add elements to the array. So if we had 12, we would be, well, let's not say 12, let's say we had 2. So we would click this twice, and then we would click this drop down, and we now have the ability to select all of the checkpoints that are in our level. So any checkpoints that we place will be populated here. And the reason we're doing this is we are in this array here defining the sequential order. So we have element 0, we have element 1. Element 0 would be our first checkpoint. Since we only have one, it's going to grab this checkpoint here. If we had a second one over here, we would assign that as the second checkpoint, and so forth, all the way down our list until we fill it out with all of our checkpoints. Now, the reason we're doing it this way, we could have used a get all actors of class node, which would automatically find all of the checkpoints in our level and automatically dump that out into an array for us. The problem with doing it that way is you're not guaranteed a consistent order in which they're added to the array. So that would be problematic. We would get all of our checkpoints, but there was no guarantee that they would put them in the sequential order that we need for our race to be successful. So doing it this way, it's just one quick little step. Once you've placed all of your checkpoints, come into this section here and then just define them in this list so that they go in sequential order and you'll be done. That's all you need to do. So since we have only one checkpoint right now, I'm just gonna delete this and click this one time and add our single checkpoint like so, so that it gets added to our checkpoint array. So with that, there's one more variable and then we're gonna create our functions and then we'll break. So let's add this last variable here. And this variable is going to be called total checkpoints. And we're going to use this to keep track of all the checkpoints that are in the level so that we know how many we have. For this, we're going to uncheck the array. We don't need to make this an array. And it's actually just going to be an integer variable type. We just need to know the number because we're going to use this to determine if we've completed a lap, when the next checkpoint should be queued up, etc. So this is not going to be publicly editable. This is just something that we're going to use for script a little bit later. So with that, the last bit of business that we have to do before we break is create some functions that we're going to use a little bit later once we start scripting. So let's go ahead and get those out of the way. So let's hop up to the My Blueprint panel, and under the Functions section, let's click the Add Function button. So there we go. And the first function that we're going to create is called UpdateTimes. We're going to use this function. We're going to add some script in here that will pass all of these custom settings for our gold, silver, all of these float values. We're going to pass those over with this function to our My Player controller blueprint. So that's going to handle that for us. Let's add another function now. Next function is going to be called LapCheck. And this function actually needs to have an input on it. So let's hop down to the Details panel down here. And we're going to click the new button for an input. We're going to call this input the checkpoint. So it's going to be an integer type. And what we're going to use this function for is to basically tell us if we've passed the total number of checkpoints. So each time we come in here, we're going to pass through the checkpoint that we just crossed. We're going to compare that against the total number of checkpoints. If it is equal to the total number of checkpoints, that means we've passed the final checkpoint and can signify a lap. Then we'll do another some other script in here to check if if we've passed and completed a lap, is the race over, etc. So there'll be a bunch of script in here determining what happens when we pass all of our checkpoints. So we got two more to create. So let's create one more here, and this one is going to be called ActivateCheckpoint. And all this function is going to do for us is, as the name suggests, queue up and activate the next checkpoint. So we're going to need to tell it what checkpoint to activate next. So in our inputs here, we're going to add an input. I'm going to click this drop down, and we're going to search for checkpoint. So our checkpoint blueprint. So let's go ahead and select that. And for the name, let's call this next checkpoint. So this is the next checkpoint to activate. And we'll add that script in here a little bit later. So we got one more function here. Let's add one more function. And this last function is going to be called race complete check. And this function needs an output. So let's hop down to the output section here. Click new. It's going to be a Boolean that we are going to return here. So it's going to be Boolean. And all this is going to say is race complete. And this function is going to handle checking to determine if our race is complete. And if it is, we're going to output that so that we can pass that information along to the relevant blueprints that need to know. So with all of that, we're about 17 minutes in. Let's go ahead and compile and save. And we're going to pause here. And in the next video, we'll pick it back up inside the tracker where we'll begin working on the event graph. We'll set up all the script we need there. And then in the following video, we will set up all the functions and we should be able to test our system here. So that's going to do it. In this video, we set up all of our custom settings. We're ready to go. In the next video, we'll begin scripting. Thank you guys for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.